Hi everyone. In the last class we discussed much about the different strategies that are used for policing and scheduling also, and also we could able to give guaranteed service, wherein we discussed the different techniques like first in first out. Then we discussed about the round robin technique. After that, the weighted fair queuing, and finally we have come out with the best solution, wherein the weighted fair queuing is using the additional techniques like token bucket technique along with the round robin. I think that is the final and the best technique that will give a complete solution to all sorts of variations in the network system. I think that is the basic step that we can take it to the next level of services. But in spite of all these scheduling and policing system, we will find a different categories of people who do expect the service from the internet system. Obviously, the network has to give support for all category of people, and all different type of services are supposed to be offered. There are different classes of services. It is measured with respect to the quantitative and qualitative also. When it comes to the quality, obviously it will be the different distinct kind of services we can expect, wherein you can see the just a minute. You can see this, we have a different customer of different category, might be in platinum, gold and silver. I think the services are offered in this way. If you look at the airways, you will have the different classes, okay, wherein you can be having the premium service and the basic services. All these will vary with respect to the kind of services that are offered to it. Obviously, they will be charged accordingly. The cost of such a service will vary. So that's why, since it is always related with the cost, it is very essential for us to give care, a lot care on to this kind of services, and hence we could able to give the best service to the expectation of the user. In the differentiated service, what we would like to do is the intermediate resources of network will be offering the best possible service according to the each individual packet. So it would be the packet flow from one user or from the different user. We have seen that the network will be experiencing a lot many users that are connected to the internet. Obviously, there will be different inflow to the network. And these inflow will have different categories of users, and they will expect different standards or class of service. So that's why it's the basic challenge to take care of all this. And even we have to look into the scalability of the network. The scalability is very, very essential nowadays. Every day the internet users are growing enormously. This grow in the internet user we'll be expecting us to scale our system, network system, to the need of the user. Obviously, it will be requiring to scale faster and to function at the different complexities and to give the best quality of service to the user. Let us look at the architecture of this. I think we can call this as the architecture of the network, wherein you can distinguish two type of network devices, you can see this is one kind, and this is yellow color is another kind. These are called edge routers. What these are? These are edge routers. And these yellow colored one are called the core routers. Then how do you distinguish these two? The functionality. Edge router is totally different. Edge router is totally different from the core router because the edge router will give service to the directly connected to the end users, and hence it has to identify the user, and then it has to classify the packets accordingly. But when it comes to the core router, most of the time this classification is done very effectively. Only thing we need to give the service according to the classified packet and the labeled services. So labeling of the service is one of the major issue with respect to the differential service. That is why we need to give such a labeling to the packets that are arriving to the either it might be an edge router or the core router. Look at the edge router. It will be having the per flow traffic management. Obviously, each user will have his own requirement, and accordingly it has to do the traffic management, and it will be making the marks up on these packets. So this is very, very important to understand, because the marking will help in distinguishing the service to each of the packet that will be arrived in the in profile and the out profile. Because the marking will tell us how fast the packet to be serviced, or otherwise it has sufficient time to wait, then it will be kept in pending to give the service to the higher priority, and then it will be given service, or otherwise it will be serviced according to the priorities that are declared in terms of the marking made on this packet. So that's why it is very, very important to do that by means of a edge router. And there are two profiles. One is an in profile and the out profile. Obviously, you can see this edge router will receive packets here, and this will, it is an inbound connectivity. What is this? It is an inbound connectivity. Here we define the in profile, because whether the packet is received with 5 hops to go or 3 hops to go. Okay, let us say 5 hops to go. After that, the outflow is, out profile is defined here. So in this, it is called outbound link. And in the outbound link, we will define the out profile. This out profile will tell that the next, the remaining hops to traverse is 4 hops, because already it has been told 5 hops in the beginning, and one it is crossed at this point and it has become 4 hops. Likewise, the inbound and outbound definitions will be varying, and also the priorities. The delay will matter at the inbound and the outbound. You can see that in the inbound, the delay remaining to reach the destination might be 5 milliseconds. At the outbound, it may go to 4 milliseconds, because already it has spent 1 millisecond in this, or otherwise it might be 2 milliseconds also sometimes. So sometimes if it becomes 0, there is a possibility that will be discarded from the network. But anyway, similarly, the core router will also have its responsibilities. Again, per class traffic management it has to do, because already the class, and hence per class traffic are supposed to be managed by the core router. Then the buffering and scheduling is based on the marking what we do on the edge router. So marking is very, very important because it will define the urgency of transmission. Whether it may wait for some time in the buffer, or it need to be processed on high priority to reach the destination at the earliest. So that's why the marking is supposed to be considered before it will be processed. And then preference in profile and out profile. Obviously, the marking itself will indicate the preference, and on that basis, the preference in the inbound and outbound, again, they will vary depending on the kind of process that will be done by the core router. So these two play a very, very important role, and they are very important to make the service to the public. Again, in the edge router, packet marking is done, and wherein you can see the profile. Before defining the profile, it may be pre-negotiated, and the rate is defined, and the bucket size is defined. All that will happen, and the per flow profile is also identified. So when it is done like this, then it will give the marking on the basis of these profiles, and it might be a class-based marking or intra-class marking is also possible. Okay, different class can be considered, and on that basis you can give service. For example, I can say that the service for packets which are of real time is one class, and non-real time packets will be another class. Like that, we can distinguish the class of packets, and accordingly we have to give service. Intra-class marking, it is the conforming the portion of flow marked differently than the non-conforming one. Sometimes there arrives a packet here. And this, I'm sorry, just a minute. Yeah, packet might be arrived here, but already it is timed out. When it is timed out, there is no point in processing it. Okay. Rather, we have to discard that packet because already it has lost its time to reach the destination. But unfortunately, it has delayed much, and in between the network it is struck, and hence now processing it to the destination is of no use. So that is what we can take care in the marking process, so that which are the packets to be discarded, which are the packet to be processed, okay? And this processing is done again on the basis of preferences and priorities. Okay, so this is the basic strategy that is being used at the edge router. You see, the edge router will be having the marking of these packets on the basis of the type of service. In case of IPv4, IPv4 header is having a segment called a type of service, 8-bit type indicator. And if you go to the IPv6, it will be having the traffic class. Both are one and the same, but the way they express will be a different one. So in the type of service, it will decide what type of service to be offered to the user, and hence the packets will be treated accordingly. So this plays a very, very important role, and here we call it as a 6-bit information, which is basically mentioned as differentiated service code point, DSCP. You can see that there are about six bits are there. Another 2 bits are there, but they are of unused. Okay. So these 6 bits will help us in deciding what is their preference, or the perhaps behavior of these packets, and these packets will be forwarded on the basis of the class of service that has been requested. Okay, I think the best example I can quote for you is that I have been reserved an internet service with what I can say the leased line. I think you might have heard about the leased line. If a 2 Mbps of leased line is different from 2 Mbps of broadband line, usually this 2 Mbps in broadband is called as 1:4, whereas here the 2 Mbps of a leased line is called 1:1. So 2 Mbps means I am expecting my application to run at a speed of 2 Mbps. But whereas here it all depends. In the worst case, it will take 1:4. It means that 2 Mbps might be an 0.5 Mbps, the worst case. Or otherwise, in the best case, it could be 1:1 also. 2 Mbps is 2 Mbps. But when these two packets are arrived at the same router, in that router, the processing priority goes to this packet than this packet. Okay, so this will not be given the priority, whereas this will be given priority, and later it will be given service. So this is very basically because that class of service is different for this, and the class of service for broadband is different. All this is indicated in your DSCP so that it is easy to the router to take decision on that basis. Now there are a certain system that have been adopted in the network. I think this is the best example how exactly the intermediate nodes will be forwarding their packets after receiving. There will be a lot of process happens in each router. That's why whenever you are calculating the total time that has taken by a packet reach from source to destination, not only the propagation time, also you consider the processing time at the routers or switches, we say. So this processing time goes here. Okay, first, as soon as it is received the packet, it will do the classification. Why it is supposed to be classified? Because the priorities are different for different packet. The class of service is different. That is why it has been classified. Once it classified, it will mark it. Okay, whether it has been required 5 milliseconds to service or 2 milliseconds to service. So likewise, the marking will be done. And once the marking is done, then goes to the shaper and dropper. What the shaper does is how fast it is to be forwarded further. It will be taken decision and it will forward with necessary corrections or updations in the packet. After that, there is another possibility that if it is already timed out, it is of no use to reach the destination, then you drop it. Okay, so the drop or shape is depending on the marker indication. Okay, the marker will give a clear indication whether to drop it or to shape it or forward it. So this is how exactly the entire network system will work. And this metering is required for all this, because any service you give, you will be going to charge for that. And meter will read all those details and it will be charged accordingly. There might be different traffic profiles are also there. Might be an average rate of transmission or burst transmission. All that is handled in the classifier and marker, and finally it will give the solution for the required system. Now forwarding on the basis of per hop behavior. You know, as I was mentioned you earlier, there will be a transmission of packets on the basis of their behavior at each level. Behavior, per hop behavior means on every intermediate level, Okay, let us assume these are routers and these are the end systems connected to it. So sender and receiver. Okay, it has been crossed through 4 routers. Okay, and these routers will forward the packet in this direction. And as soon as it receives, every router will do all these metering operation. It will classify the packet, then it will mark it, and then it will be forwarded on that basis. But when it goes in this direction, it has to look into it, because at this point, the time that is required to reach a timeout is 10 milliseconds. But when it comes to here, it might be an 8 millisecond. When it comes to here, it might be 5 millisecond, or it may be 1 millisecond at this point. It means that it has to perform this, process this packet immediately without any delay, because within 1 millisecond, it should reach the destination. Okay, so that is the per hop behavior. So it has to be identify the behavior of each packet at each hop. These are called hops: 1 hop, 2 hop, 3 hop, 4 hop. Like this, number of hops will be identified per hop behavior, how it is taken, why it has taken 2 millisecond here, why it has taken 3 millisecond, why it has taken 4 millisecond. All that is defined on the basis of processing time that has been achieved taken here, and also propagation time. So we cannot define exactly how it will be varying. But at each level, on the basis of the criteria and the class of the packet, it is to be performed. Okay, so that's why the router has to take care of per hop behavior of the packet, and accordingly it is supposed to take an action to forward it. As I told, expedited forwarding means if already a class has already packet has already lost its timeout period, and forwarding it to a next level might be very, very difficult. It might be dropped. And at the same time, if it's time to live, TTL we call. I think you might have heard about this also in the header of TCP, time to live. If it is mentioned 3 means another 3 hop, after 3 hop it is going to die out, or it is the packet is supposed to be discarded. So this 3 hop, it has to reach the destination. So that is the expedited forwarding to be done, and the assured forwarding wherein the guaranteed minimum amount of bandwidth is utilized, and with each drop preference partitions are supposed to be taken care. And of course, when it comes to the basic fact of life, that traffic demand might be beyond the link capacity. You can see the quality of service can be offered only when at least minimum expected resources are available in the network. You can see these two. This user is expecting 1 Mbps, and this user is expecting 1 Mbps. We'll be using the common link. This is the common link, and the capacity of this link is only 1.5 Mbps. But when you process these two, it requests 2 Mbps. The demand is 2 Mbps, but the availability is 1.5 Mbps. If I am giving this share to both, probably each will take 0.75 Mb, 0.75 Mb. But do you think, is it sufficient to ensure the quality of service? Never, because the quality of service comes only when sufficient bandwidth is provided. So a fractional bandwidth, if you offer to any given application, it will not be really sufficient for this. So that's why, instead of offering the partial capacity, what we do is, the full capacity is offered. But when we offer full capacity to one of the user, the other user cannot be offered. So only you can give permission to one user on the basis of resources. Okay, so you can admit the call on the basis of available resource, might be a bandwidth or the processing capacity. So that's why the best example you might have seen in the telephone system, if there is a connection happened between two users and the second person is trying to connect, it will give an engaged tone. It is an indication that he has been engaged with one and he has the resources are used. And even in the best example for resource limitation is in the rural area, if you are making the call, the call will not at all forward it to the destination. Okay, it will take some time, then you will be getting the beeps continuously. The reason is the what we say the exchange office in the telephone has reached its fullest extent of service or fullest numbers of service. Suppose it has capacity of 100 units to 100 calls to service, 100 calls are already connected. The 101st call cannot be given service. That time they will be kept in pending and waiting or what you say the engaged tone will be observed by the sender. So this is how exactly the system works. What you need to understand from this is resource allocation is possible only if it is sufficient to the user requirement. If it is not, then you allocate one after the other. Yeah, then how do you do the resource allocation or call setup? So for the call setup, usually in the initial stage, there will be one phase called call setup phase. We call it as call setup phase. It is a control phase in general, we call technically. During this time, before the connection is established between the source and the destination, one request goes from source to the destination and a reply comes back to here saying that I am ready to receive your call. And all the resources during that period, all these resources are reserved. Okay, reservation of resources is done. Okay, so after reservation, further communication of data will take place from source to destination. This process is done by means of a special protocol called as RSVP, Reservation Protocol. So this protocol will help to reserve the resources as and when it is required by such a system. And once you give such a reservation of the resources, it is always, you can ensure a good quality of service. And of course, there are a lot of techniques being adopted, like weighted fair queuing, or it might be token bucket technique, whatever it might be. Right, then I think we have discussed much about the topic, and let us conclude this entire discussion of multimedia networking. I think multimedia networking is a most exciting technique in case of the internet, because you know, the internet is liked by people for the most of the multimedia applications. There are enormous applications are there in the internet for multimedia usage, especially nowadays you have the YouTube, Netflix, Skype, Facebook, WhatsApp, whatnot. You have enough amount of applications. All these applications will be enjoying the use of internet. And of course, once these applications are demanded by the customer, it is the responsibility of network to provide expected quality of service. So on that context, we discussed about the streaming the live video transmission. And we have discussed all the possible difficulties in it and the solutions. And we told that there is always a possibility of a jitter in the network. And due to this jitter, there will be a variation in delay between the different packets movement to the destination. And hence buffering is essential. And buffering is a trade-off, how much to be buffered and when to buffer and all that will be decided on that basis. Then comes the stored video streaming, wherein we'll be adopting three different type of technique. One is UDP, User Datagram Protocol. The other one is Hypertext Transfer Protocol. The third one is an adaptive Hypertext Transfer Protocol. Even we discussed much about the throughput significance, because you know that any transmission is more efficient only when we have enough throughput in communication. And after that, we took the support of CDN. It's a special networking system. It is an overlay over the physical topology, so that you can manage the connection very well. And that will be the best solution for streaming the video packets. And after that, we discussed even about the voice over internet protocol. I think this voice over internet protocol uses the best effort technique. And I was discussed much about the best effort technique, saying that it is the one basic algorithm which will run the packets from source to destination, irrespective of the path being adopted by it, so that the packets will reach the destination at the earliest with least effort. Okay, so that's why best effort is more oftenly advantageous for the real-time applications like audio and video applications. Then we even spoke about the loss tolerant delay sensitivity, because you know, real-time application will not tolerate much delay. Okay, if you have a buffering of 5 seconds, within 5 seconds the packet must reach the destination. Then the client buffer size, as mentioned you earlier, that the buffer size is negotiable. And then finally the time stamping, whether to continue the forwarding of packet or to destroy, it all depends on the time stamping. Or even the time stamping will help us to understand the urgency of a packet to forward in the network. Finally, we discussed on the scheduling and pulsing. And I think, you know, think any system can work effectively and efficiently only if you have proper planning and scheduling. So the same thing applies to the network system for the multimedia communication, wherein different scheduling and policy systems have been adopted, so that we could able to give a proper justification to the communication of multimedia applications. With this, I think I'm very happy that I could able to deliver my lectures through this medium. And I hope that all of you have received a good amount of information from our side, and it will be very much beneficial to everyone. With this, I thank you everyone for having cooperated. Thank you very much. Thank you.